We have to not only treat people with love and respect and dignity, we have to tell them that I see you and I see you for who you are and I respect you and I love you. I've been in so many settings where we just talk about the biology and the science, but let's also just talk about love for our fellow human beings. That's another reason to work on global health. When I sit in front of the foundation or I sit in a large venue with a large audience, I need to talk about the fact that it's love, it's compassion for our fellow human being that helps us listen and bring these solutions that we have in the West. And then it's up to other people to decide, do they want these solutions, do they not?
In this series, we have talked a lot about how powerful we can be when humans team up. How together we can accomplish so much and tackle seemingly insurmountable problems. Culture is what shapes these relationships across our planet. We must appreciate and respect every culture and work with the people we hope to help. To do this, we need to seek first to understand. To do this well, we need to explore how countless forces have shaped the modern world throughout history, such as colonialism, slavery, war, religion, gender bias, nationalism, and market forces. To truly understand a culture, we need to spend time listening and learning. We need to seek to understand each other's language, values, and traditions. This is the sixth lesson. Respect the culture. Culture matters. I am Zainab Salbi, founder of Women for Women International. Thank you for joining me to explore how we can become better ancestors. In 1980, the World Health Organization declared the world free from smallpox. Smallpox had been responsible for hundreds of millions of deaths, but now the world, all its people, and future generations are free from smallpox. In this series, we are learning 9 lessons from global health to change the world, from the heroes who wiped out smallpox from the face of our planet. These extraordinary efforts have never been more relevant as countries struggle to control the COVID-19 pandemic. To be good ancestors, we need to leave the world better than when we found it. We can start by learning critical lessons from those who have achieved major change in our world to guide us today and into tomorrow. We need to prepare for future threats. We face challenges that require us to think beyond our lifespans to the impact we will have on our future generations. What kind of world do we want to leave for future generations? How will they judge us for what we did or did not do when we had the chance? Do we turn our backs on the future? Or choose to become good ancestors. Throughout these 9 episodes, we will explore essential lessons learned from smallpox eradication, hearing from key experts on how each lesson has been applied or used as we prepare for future global health threats. In this episode, we will explore the importance of respecting cultures. Through the smallpox eradication program, Nigerian leaders had proved that surveillance and containment strategy could work. But in bringing this strategy to India, the smallpox team needed to be aware of and respectful of the Indian culture, a culture so different from that of Nigeria. Dr. Susmita Parashar is a cardiologist at the Emory Heart and Vascular Center and associate professor of medicine at Emory University School of Medicine. She is a passionate clinician researcher and educator and trains medical students, residents, and cardiology fellows. In addition to being an accomplished medical figure in her own right, Dr. Parashar's career was inspired by her father-in-law and mentor, Dr. Mahendra Datta, who was a field expert working for the Indian government during the height of the smallpox epidemic in India. He ultimately rose to become India's Deputy Director General of Public Health. Dr. Bill Fagey is a legend in public health. He served as director of the Center for Disease Control under President Carter and Reagan. After serving 6 years as the head of the CDC, Dr. Fagey co-founded the Task Force for Child Survival, now the Task Force for Global Health, and joined the Carter Center as its first executive director. In 2012, President Barack Obama awarded Dr. Fagey the Presidential Medal of Freedom the nation's highest civilian honor for his work in global health, in particular for helping to eradicate smallpox.
India is home to hundreds of ethnic and religious sects, languages and traditions, creating a rich tapestry that could feel both beautiful and overwhelming from a public health perspective. In 1960s India, smallpox was raging unabated, while in most other countries it had been eliminated. The government of India had launched the National Smallpox Eradication Program with a focus on mass vaccination of the population. By 1966, the Indian government reported approximately 60 million primary vaccinations. Mass vaccinations campaign had become part of the culture, and there was wide trust in the singular approach. In most countries, vaccinating 80% of the population over 5 years was considered sufficient to interrupt smallpox transmission.
We now know that is not true.
India needed a new strategy, and they were willing to try things that had worked in Africa. You have to remember how difficult this would be for people to make that decision if they've been using one strategy for decades. And so if you tangle with culture, culture will always win. And if you try to tell someone that their culture is wrong, they will react negatively. So with all of these different cultures in India, what do you do? Well, the Indian government did a very smart thing. They had people come in from the outside who had worked on smallpox, 60 at one time. They matched each of those special epidemiologists with a health worker from that area who knew the language, knew the culture, could protect them from making mistakes. And it improved so fast that now instead of thinking this may take years, we were saying this could happen in a year, this could happen in 18 months at the most. But the pressure was being applied to the Minister of Health of Bihar because that's where the largest number of cases were occurring every day. And the pressure was, we've got to go back to mass vaccination. The Minister of Health believed that. And he attended our meeting when we would have people come in from around the state once a month to report on what was working, what was not working. And to everyone's surprise, he said, at the end of this meeting, we will stop surveillance containment and we will go back to mass vaccination. And with that, the room was totally silent. We didn't know what to do next.
Fortunately, a young Indian physician stood up and explained to the minister that in my village, if a house is on fire, no one wastes time putting water on nearby houses just in case the fire spreads. They rush to pour water only where it will do the most good, on the burning house. This is the same strategy we are trying to use in eradicating smallpox, the surveillance and the containment strategy.
The Minister of Health of Bihar sat there silent because now someone from his culture had explained why we were doing it this way. And he stared at the audience and we sat there not knowing what he was going to say next. And finally he said, I'll give you one more month. In the following month, we were able to show improvement in smallpox in 3 of the 30 districts of Bihar. When he returned to the meeting a month later, he saw that progress and he said, I'll give you one more month. In the second month, we improved so fast that the question never was raised again.